喂，大家好啊！又嚟到我哋今集共聚会。咁我哋今集咧就，如果大家睇到咧，就是、我哋有嘉宾啦。咁我哋首先有我同会长
，hello
做 host 嘅。咁今日我哋有一位特别嘉宾，因为我哋今日嘅主题咧系讲意大利。
睇翻幅地图就系讲翻 Tuscany 啦。因为我哋好耐冇讲翻 Tuscany 啦，其实呢个系大家啲听众咧好想。學多啲關於嘅意大利酒，你唔可能唔知道 Tuscany，
因為亦都係最重要嘅產區。
嗱，前幾個禮拜我哋請咗呢、這個Knights of Elba 嘅新會長
Alan Cock，
係啦，就講咗好多 Piedmont 嘅嘢。而家我哋講 Tuscany，
Piedmont，
咁而家呢個就係 Tuscan， 呢個點讀啊 ？Toscana，
啊
英文就 Tuscany， 咪 Toscana。咁啊，今日個嘉賓好有淵源嘅，咁佢你知大家都如果飲 Tuscany 嘅或者 Toscana 酒啦，尤其是 Brunello 咧，識有個大牌子啊，叫做 Banfi。
Banfi 非常出名嘅酒牌。
咁 Paolo 咧就係 Banfi 駐香港嘅總代表。咁 Paolo 咧就老香港人嚟㗎啦，佢嚟咗香港成十幾年㗎啦。咁另外咧就係你知咧，我同何總咧就係 Society of Wine Educators 嘅 CWE 啊嘛。咁其實 Banfi 喺美國咧就好 X 大嘅一間公司嚟嘅。
非常有名㗎，係多非常之勢力非常雄厚，
好勁嘅，即係佢基本上係除咗黑手黨之外咧，最大嘅一個意大利人 own 嘅一個 organisation 啦。
咁勁嘅咩
？I think the second biggest to mafia in America. Okay,
no, wait, the first one is number one is not FCA, Fiat Chrysler.
Oh, yes.Yes,
I think it's
yes,
FCA,
yes, yes.
The biggest Italian company in the US.
I guess so, yeah. Because nowadays...
Yeah, Jesse 有少少係中情講少啦。咁咧，你知道 Society Y Educator 背後咧一個大金主就係 Banfi 啦。Banfi sponsor 好多嘢嘅。咁你諗下，喂 ，Banfi 間酒莊嘅 sponsor 咁多嘢，嗱，搞清楚 ，Banfi 係一間好大嘅酒莊。佢基本上咧喺意大利咧，尤其是 Brunello 咧，佢係擁有最多嘅 vineyard 嘅。咁喺意大利嚟講咧，佢係。單一連續嘅田咧係最大嘅一間酒嘅公司咧，係 own 一個連續嘅單一嘅連續嘅田，成即係計埋佢啲附近啲設施成2000几個 hectare 嘅，就喺 Brunello 嗰度。咁但係當然你話總嘅田數可能 Antinori 都會大過佢啦，但係如果連續即係 continuous 嘅咧，就係 Banfi。咁但係喺美國 Banfi 咧有少少咧，除咗佢係本身 Banfi 係做酒之外咧，美國嘅 Banfi 咧本身係一間。意大利酒的 importer， 好多意大利酒和食品的 importer 都是叫 Banfi，
所以咁大。
佢其實最初做 importer 喺意大利入酒，去入人哋啲酒，做到大到咧，佢1970几年咧就翻翻意大利買田買地，就用自己 Banfi 嘅名字去做翻 Banfi wine 嘅。嚇，咁呢個可以遲啲阿 Paolo 可以再介紹。
係咪紐約啲Little Italy 嗰啲人嚟㗎？
I don't know. So, well, then we can switch back to English now. And then, okay. Welcome, Paolo.
Thank you.
Yes, and for visiting us. And we just talk about, you know, that Banfi is a big sponsor for Society of Wine Educator in America. And Banfi started as actually one of the biggest importer for the Italian wines. And other than wine, they also import other things, right? Food.
Historically, they start importing because the company in US go back to 1919. So basically, last year we celebrate 100 years of history of Banfi in United States.
Oh, in last year?
Yes, 1919.
Oh. Wow, okay. And then it grew so big and got very rich. And so in 1970s, it went back to Italy and bought land and then start making wine under the brand
Where
of Banfi.
Where was Banfi started? Where in the US?
Oh, absolutely. In New York.
That's what I said. It must be in New York. Little Italy. Must be those guys.
But you know that there is a beautiful history about Banfi because the family that owned Banfi living in the United States.
Not Corleone.
Long Island. No. We are from the north. We are from Milan. That is nothing to do with the mafia.
Mafia made from the south of Naples and
Sicily. In this case, nothing to do with mafia. It's a beautiful history because it's related with something very important in Italy, with the Pope house.
Yeah.
Because the family that owned Banfi is the Mariani family. So the surname is Mariani. And they decided to name the company Banfi in the honor of Teodolinda Banfi. Who was Teodolinda Banfi? Teodolinda Banfi was the aunt of the founder of Banfi in the United States. And she was a very important woman because she was the first woman to be admitted to live in the Vatican City without to be a nun. because she was adopted when she was a young girl from the Ratti family. The Ratti family was the family of Pio XI. Pio XI was an important pope during the beginning of last century, and she became the head of the house of the pope. And she was admitted to live. She today is the only woman, without to be a nun, to be buried in Vatican City.
Wow!
In the honor of this important lady, they decided to name the company as Banfi in the 1919. Beautiful history, nothing to do with mafia, but something to do with history, legacy, and in this case, religion.
Yeah, well, even today, Banfi also have a very powerful lady called Sharon McCarthy. She was a president for the Society of Educators. She also a president for Banfi too, right, for a time. And she is in charge of all the training. Because training is very important for Banfi, but there's many, many employees. And she's in charge of training them, all but the
rhinologists. Right now, is it still family owned or?
Absolutely, we are family owned, and I completely agree with you. Education for us is one of the pillars of our business. As you know, Banfi is even one of the main partners of Cornell University when we're talking about wine education. And we support so many wine programs all around the world, university in Ireland, university in the United States, university, of course, in Italy, because we have a foundation. And the main mission of our foundation is really to develop the knowledge of wine all around the world.
Okay. Yeah, so short, Banfi 喺好主要一間教育酒嘅教育公司咁啊。除咗係我哋 SWE 背係一個大大嘅支持者之外咧，
金主
佢同康乃爾大學即係Cornell University 都好多合作。
Cornell University actually 係美國最好嘅 hospitality program.
Yes,
the best hospitality
program in North America.
So I think so. Our audience is eager to learn about Tuscany now or Toscana.
Toscana.
So let's talk about anything about Toscana wine, the food, and. And the scenic beauties of the land.
Well, first of all, we have to know that Toscana, the most important city in Toscana, in Tuscany, is Firenze.
Firenze.
Firenze, or Florence.
Yes, I think for foreigners, we always learn about Toscana, Firenze.
We always say in English it's Florence, but in Italian it should be Firenze.
Firenze, but actually, if in the history of Toscana, Siena also a very important city.
We'll talk about that afterwards.
Later. Okay,
because I think the real beauty is in Siena.
Yes,
two beautiful cities. You're completely right. And I believe when we're talking about Tuscany, the most important word is really beauty. Because it's a region that has so much to offer in terms of beauty of landscape, in terms of beauty of the architecture, in terms of the history, because as you know, Tuscany was the homeland of the Renaissance, when all the Western civilization moved from the Middle Age to the New Era. So it's a really important place, and then is the reason why Florence is so famous all around the world. It's famous more than anything for art, architecture and beauty, and then thank you God is even extremely famous all around the world for wine and food, because Tuscany, as we know, is well known really everywhere, thank you to the popularity of the important and popular wine like Chianti Classico, of course Brunello di Montalcino, they represent the pinnacle of the production.
Okay, so let's first, where's Toscana, Italy?
Absolutely. Toscana is basically at the center of the country. The Latin people was used to say virtud in media stat. What is the meaning? The good is in the middle. And Toscany is really in the middle of Italy. And it's a very nice area even in terms of weather, because the weather is between continental weather in some part, especially in the northern part of the region, and the Mediterranean weather in the south and the center part of the region. So incredible weather, very, very pleasant. Landscape, you have to know that the Tuscany have seven human heritage site inside to the region. It's one of the highest concentration of human heritage. Exactly, in the world.
Yeah, that's a UNESCO World Heritage.
And one of that, and then was before any other wine area in the world, is dedicated to the beauty of the landscape, because the Val d'Orcia, in 2004, was rated the human heritage not for the beauty of the castle, of the beauty of the painting, but for the beauty of the hill. Mm. And that was the first time in the world that UNESCO decided to give that kind of a prize to one area, one region. After that, many others, now even Prosecco, Porto, after Champagne and Burgundies in 2015.
Tokaj as well.
We go back to 2004. Mm. Really to explain to you how important is Tuscany in terms of culture and beauty, because culture and beauty is deeply related to quality.
So can you give people some idea of what the landscape looked like?
Of course.
Especially that is about the hill, right?
The rolling hills of Tuscany.
These
are the rolling hills.
Exactly. Okay. This is really one of the most iconic pictures from Tuscany. We are in the Val d'Orcia. You can see the beauty of the hill. I can tell you, it's really a place that is blessed by God. In the sense that we go there, when you go there, you really feel absorbed, involved from the beauty of the landscape. Wow. Another good thing is it's a place where the season count. Those pictures can be shown to you in four different moments of the year. It's completely changed. Mm. Now it's green because it's springtime. Mm-hmm. Then it will become yellow during the season of the wheat. And then it will become brown in the autumn when we work the land. So the land really follow the season the season basically. A change with the season. It's very, very unique. Mm. It's quite important because once again, season having great impact on quality of wine too. Mm. Because as we said, the fact that we have different season during the growing season of the vines, we are able to create first vines and then wine with more richness and complexity.
And during winter, does it get very cold?
That depends where you are. For example, if you are in Montalcino, definitely yes. Why? Because Montalcino, for example, is a very high village. We are over 500 meters above the sea level. That area is very cold, and that is very good because help to develop more flavor and more complexity in the grapes. But for example, if you go next to the coast, in this way, or for example on the island of Tuscany, like Isola d'Elba, exactly, the weather is definitely more continental.
Can you
more,
show where the relative location of the Montalcino versus the Chianti? And
we can see from here, you can see the green part is the Chianti Classico region.
Okay.
So that is really very close to Florence. We mentioned before another beautiful city, Siena. Chianti Classico is the historic area. You have to know that Chianti Classico is the oldest appellation in the world. In the 1715, Granduca Cosimo de' Medici created for the first time in the history of the world one appellation for wine to defend the prestige of that area.
I think these days there's a TV soap opera in the US, Medici, about the Medici family.
You come
right.
So if you have watched that, you know the Medici family used to control this area.
Very strongly. The Medici family was the, you know, Italy became a country in the 19th century. Mm. So before was a constellation of a kingdom so basically Tuscany was independent always. Mm. And it was run by that incredible family that was the Medici. Mm. Medici was really the family behind the Renaissance.
And up in Piedmont was a Sforza. Sforza family.
Exactly. Sforza, yes.
You watched that. There's also another TV series, the Buongiorno, about 7 years ago, about the Pope. Mm-hmm. And he's talked a lot about the Sforza family in the Piedmont.
Yeah. And the Medici, as he said, and that area is the Chianti Classico. Then you can see Montalcino is that area that is purple. You can see it's a very small area.
Purple area.
Exactly.
The purple. Oh,
the purple pink area.
Purple is this. The pink one. Correct.
Yes, the pink one.
The pink one.
Not the island.
No, not the island.
The island, the color is a little bit...
It's a kind of red, pink, and then Isola d'Elba. Yeah. A beautiful place, for wine, but even for leisure, because it's a lovely island. That was the place where the Napoleon
was first exiled.
Exactly. Because you probably know that even the family of Napoleon was original from Tuscany. Because Buonaparte is an Italian name, and his father was original from Tuscany. So that is...
Because people on Corsica Island, they're either from Genoa, from Liguria, or from Tuscany.
Exactly. From the coast, basically.
Yes.
So, and then, once again, always when I'm talking about Tuscany, there is so many things. I want to even share with you something that is not related directly to the wine, but is strongly related to the culture. For example, one of the most important writers in the Western world is Dostoevsky. Dostoevsky wrote so many romans.
Well, he's a Russian.
He lived in Tuscany for 1 year.
Okay.
He wrote one of his more important romans, that is The Idiots. In Florence. But in Florence, he wrote one of the most famous phrases of Dostoevsky. Dostoevsky wrote, La bellezza salverà il mondo. The beauty will save the world. Mm-hmm. He was inspired by Florence, by the beauty of Florence. And another one, a French writer, Stendhal.
Stendhal,
you know, he became famous more than for his writer.
Black. Exactly. Love. You have Google, the writer.
But Stendhal became famous in the world because there is this kind of disease that is called the Stendhal disease. That what is that? The syndrome of Stendhal. That is a sense of you feel lost when you have so much beauty around you. And Stendhal described the syndrome when he was in Santa Croce in Tuscany, in Florence. That is really beautiful.
Was Toscana hit badly by the COVID virus?
Luckily, no. Because the main problem in Italy about the COVID was really in the north part of the country. Piedmont, Lombardy, Veneto, but more than anything, Lombardy.
Oh, that's lucky.
Milan was very, very affected. Yeah.
That's why in Toscana is a standout set. I mean, your beauty, you forgot the virus.
The disease.
Right.
And, but luckily, Tuscany wasn't really affected. Really, in Italy, 70% of the problem was related to Lombardy, and then Piemonte and
Because the cities are there.
Yeah.
But outside of the cities, you know, I mean, Tuscany outside of Firenze, it's basically villages.
I can give you a number to let you understand, for example, to make a parallel with Hong Kong. You know, in Montalcino is one of the biggest community in Italy. Basically all the area of Montalcino is 30,000 hectares. So living in Montalcino, in the community of Montalcino, 5,000 people. So every square kilometer there is 19 people. You know how many people living in Mongkok for a square kilometer? 70,000. So it's a really a very big difference, and then for sure will help a little bit less concentration.
Yeah, that's a natural social distance.
Exactly, even if you don't
Natural social distance.
Exactly.
All right, so we can, shall we talk?
So that's Firenze.
Talking about the beauty of Florence, talking about the landscape. That, for example, is a beautiful cellar. In the Val d'Orcia, in Montepulciano, that was a cellar that was designed. Designed basically by Saint Brunelleschi. So it's incredible. It's a cathedral under the soil of Montepulciano. That, for example, is San Gimignano. Correct. We mentioned before, Tuscany is famous in the world, of course, for the red wine. Chianti Classico, Nobile di Montepulciano and Brunello. 80% of the wine in Tuscany are red. But there is one exception, as is this city.
We call this the Hong Kong of medieval time.
Bravissimo.
Because look at the tower.
Bravissimo. That was really because in the old days to have a tower was a symbol of power. Today the tower are basically around 12 or 13, but originally they was over 30 or 40. All the most important family create a tower to show the power. And still today is even this village is human heritage by UNESCO. is very beautiful.
Together with Volterra and one more, I forgot which
Bravissimo.
One.
And the center of Siena, the center of Florence, the Isole Medice, the Ville Medice, etc.
Luca as well.
Luca, the center.
Yes.
For example, another thing that we didn't mention is music. Luca is the land of Puccini.
Puccini
is probably one of the most famous Italian writers, with La Tosca, for example, or La Turandot. Turandot, you know, when our famous singer Nessun Dorma, Domani Vincerò, that is a very famous area, it was from Puccini, it was from Tuscany too. Really a magic, magic area. And then I won't give you
Pisa,
that is the most iconic symbol of Tuscany. Why I want to show Pisa? Because Pisa is a mistake, but it became unique thank you to a mistake. Wine is not about perfection. Wine is about unicity. I believe this tower represents what has to be our goal as wine producer. Not perfection, but identity, unicity.
But that's what we say about Italian wines, right? Sometimes we feel that, okay, a lot of Italian wines, you can find wine fault, yes. From a winemaking point of view, most of them not very clean, but they're unique and they have the character. That's part of the Italian image. That it's not perfect, but it's good. It tastes good.
I mean, so when, you know, there is, you know better than me, in the world there are two categories of wine. There is wine as a commodity that you don't drink to have emotion. You drink to enjoy yourself, to eat with your food. And then, of course, the priority is to be consistent, nice, and value for money. Yeah. But then there is another category of wine, that are wine that play with emotion. There are the premium wine. Premium wine, as I said, identity is more important than anything else. Because when you pay those money, you're looking for feeling. You don't looking for anything else. Tuscany represents, you know, the total production of wine in Tuscany is 300 million bottles of wine. You know what is the world production of wine? Roughly, we are talking about 30 billion bottles of wine in the world. So Tuscany represents 0.5% of the world production of wine. But it's so famous. You know that in Tuscany, in the last 20 years, for four times, the most important wine magazine in the world rated a wine from Tuscany best wine in the world. No many other area in the world have this kind of ability. Yes, Bordeaux, but Bordeaux produce 900 million bottles of wine. But Tuscany produce 300 million, three times less. And so that is really Tuscany what it's about. It's about quality and personality. That I...
Well, shall we try our first wine?
Oh, why not?
Yeah, so
let's go first wine.
Ah, so this wine is a super Tuscan. Wine I bring this wine. The name is Cum Laude. That means with honor.
Because it's not Italian. It's not Latin.
Latin, bravissimo, bravissimo. That is a Latin word.
But usually it comes with your university, you know, diploma.
Bravissimo, bravissimo.
It means basically with honor.
So
it means
a one class of the important wine. Tuscan is just called a super Tuscan. Can you encant this very quickly?
Okay.
And explain what super Tuscan is about.
Super Tuscany 其實一個其實都係八幾年開始個 trend 嚟嘅，八幾年係嘛？有冇
錯？
七幾年八幾啦，係啦，80s啦。咁就就喺意大利嗰度有啲人覺得，咦？我哋俾啲法國酒好似拋離咗好遠喎。咁法國酒而家喺世界上好賣得喎。咁我哋喺意大利點解唔種下啲即係？佢揾翻啲其實意大利都種咗好多年嘅，就即係以前都一路種開 Cabernet Sauvignon 啊、Merlot 啊嗰啲，但係就一路啲人都唔正視佢，就因為覺得喂呢啲法國嘢又唔係我哋意大利嘢。咁但係去到 Super Tuscan 嗰時，嗰班即係嗰個 movement 嗰陣時咧，啲人就話喂，咁我哋有嗰啲扎咁嘅葡萄，我哋點解唔攞嚟追下法國佬試下得唔得咧？咁就用法國嘅方法，即係用波多嘅方法去想做一隻波多嘅酒啦。
係啦，
喺意大利，
但係佢又唔係限翻淨係博多葡萄，
佢有啲會 blend 少少 Sangiovese 嘅，
係好多時都 blend 埋啲 Sangiovese 嘅，
但係就因為 Sangiovese 嘅弱個 cap 好多，其實基本上喺個 blend 入邊唔見咗嘅好多時。
Okay, so this is a Cum Laude, right?
Cum Laude is a wine.
Cum Laude.
Cum Laude.
Cum Laude is the Super Tuscany made by Banfi.
It's one of the Super Tuscan made by Banfi. Why I bring this wine? Because I want to try to represent the eclecticity of the terroir of Tuscany. This wine is done with four different grapes. Sangiovese, by the way, Sangiovese represents 65% of the grapes in Tuscany. Cabernet Sauvignon represents 5% of the wine in Tuscany. Merlot represents 4 or 5% of the wine in Tuscany, and Syrah. So this wine really,
Syrah,
Merlot, wow. Syrah, Cabernet Sauvignon and Sangiovese, wow. All the main grapes that you could find in the terroir of Tuscany. It's a super Tuscan, that means it's a wine a little bit more contemporary.
But Syrah, you cannot say it's a major grape in Italy, right? It's a it's a very small percentage, I think.
Absolutely, very,
very, very small. Very small.
What's the vintage of that?
2015. This one is 2015, a great vintage.
Okay, let's take a short break. After that, then we'll talk about the
wine.
Cheers. The tasting note of the wine.
Okay. Fantastic.
Yes.